just went over to 275 Halstead. 384 Stuyvesant. He gonna take it over to 155 Morgan.
Just another day living in the hood. Just another day around the way. Feeling good today.
Well, good evening, Trinidad and Tobago. After a spirited presentation, live broadcast from the ILP, we of course move along with our own brand of conversation as it relates to elections 2015 with another edition of The Chair here on STV Real TV. My name is O'Brien Haynes, and once again I'd like to thank you for taking the time out to join us a bit later than usual tonight, and even so compounded by the fact that the broadcast ran a little over a little later than it was supposed to, so that of course we're trying to make up the time, and I do hope that our guest this evening will of course accommodate us. We've got inside as usual a spirited panel, and for those of you who've never seen this show before, this is where we get a chance to allow young voters in Trinidad and Tobago a chance to have a one-on-one conversation with those who put themselves up for that opportunity to enter public office, and some of them who've been in it for some time giving us a one-on-one on not just what the electoral process is like, but indeed what the process of government is like and some of the inner workings and problems and challenges that have been experienced. And I mean, over the series so far, it's been extremely interesting. And now that we're getting down to the final few weeks, final few days of the elections, it's becoming even more intense and more interesting. In fact, today itself, so many interesting things happened. I'm very keen to hear how the panel is going to assess the entire conversation this evening. So I'm not going to hold it too very long. Our special guest this evening, I'd like to welcome her, Minister in the Ministry of Water, Resources and the Environment. She is also the elections officer for the United National Congress and the candidate for Couva North, Ms. Ramona Ramdial. Ramona, welcome
Hi.
To the program.
Thank you very much.
It's good to have you on the
Thank
inside.
You.
And I must say that if you haven't had a chance to look at the program before, you're in for a very special treat.
This
is
look forward to it.
An intimate conversation. My job, although I hold the title as moderator, is simply to introduce the show and future commercial breaks. What you're going to have is a conversation with our panel and an interesting dialogue. I will only step in when and if they get out of hand, but
sure.
I doubt that will happen. I think you're quite capable as we move along. So
Thank
once
you.
Again, welcome to
Thank
the experience
you.
And to the panel.
Oh
yes, I should also mention, yes, she is. Thanks for giving me that heads up. You are the first female.
Thank you, thank you.
So now that we've expanded to Tuesdays and Thursday nights, I hope that we probably have some more women coming in as we go
yeah.
along. All right. So let's open the conversation. Good evening, panel. How are you all doing this evening? Everyone's fine?
Yeah.
Everybody ready to go? Okay, who's gonna go first?
I'm
First.
Okay, so let's get the thing started. Welcome to the chair, folks.
Good evening, Ms. Ramdial.
Hi.
My name is Shonda Latouche of the PNM Youth League. I have two short questions, which I hope you can really honestly answer.
Sure.
I would like to think that we are in the heat of an election campaign right now. When I look at my party, the PNM, our caravan is rolling into different communities every night on the planet, talking to the people, addressing issues, and talking about our policies. Why, to me, I haven't seen, you know, the People's Partnership, like, you all have the Monday night forum, but how come we're not seeing, like, that continuous flow of meetings, talking to the people, like, pushing out your policies? How come there's not a continuous amount of public meetings going on? Secondly, why is the approach of your campaign Kamala 2015? Even the billboards that I see of the Honorable Prime Minister, it's just her. There's not even the logo of the United National Congress or any other logos of the other parties that make up the partnership. Why this central focus on the Honorable Prime Minister? There are 40 other candidates, including you.
Mm-hmm.
Why not highlight your, let us see y'all? Because I'm not familiar with some of y'all. Why not showcase yourselves? It can't only be focused on Madam Prime Minister.
Okay. First of all, to address your first question, we are in every single constituency. We are also on media live. You have the Prime Minister conversations. You have conversations with the candidates and the Prime Minister. We also have the teleforums, and we are across Trinidad and Tobago. We have the Monday night forums. We also last week had a rally in South, So that was Wednesday, and then we were in St. Augustine on Sunday. So we are well aware, we are on media, we are on the airwaves, we're everywhere, we're in everybody's homes. So I really want to disagree with you saying that we are not as, you know, upfront and foremost in the media as the PNM, according to you, that is. Yeah. Secondly, with respect to the CAMLA 2015, now you have to understand that we are in a partnership comprising of many other political parties. And we and our strategy as the partnership is, of course, a leadership. We see it as a leadership competition in this 2015 elections. So it's our Honorable Prime Minister, Kamala Prasad Bisesa, versus that of Dr. Keith Rowley in terms of leadership and who is going to lead us into the future, into 2015 and beyond. Notwithstanding that, I think the candidates are also making their rounds in the media. They've been introduced. When we have our meetings, we are introduced on stage just as the PNM, they are also. We are sitting there, we are behind the Prime Minister when she speaks and all of that. So we are well in media, and a lot of the incumbents who are now candidates for the 2015 elections, they are also well known. The thing about it is there's a different because you are already known as a government. We have served 5 years. We are known. We know the candidates. The new candidates are being a little more highlighted as opposed to the incumbents. So therefore, you would see some of the new candidates more than you would see me. But over the past 5 years, however, I've been working in my ministry, working as MP, going to the different media houses, PRing my work. So I think that we have a very good strategy going forward into the elections. And CAMLA 2015, you spoke about not seeing the UNC logo. But it is common knowledge that she's the leader of the United National Congress. And therefore, as I said before, we see it as a leadership competition in this general elections.
Minister, good
yes,
night.
Good night.
My name is Edward Young. I represent Take Back TT with my colleagues in the front row here.
Hi.
Just as a follow-up to my colleague's question, is it that you're saying that the populace should ignore the virtues or the shortcomings of their individual candidates in their constituency?
Definitely
and vote
not
solely on whether or not they believe the Prime Minister is more capable than Dr. Rowley or, for example, Mr. Warner to
right
lead the country?
Yes. No, definitely not. I'm not saying that. However, our focus is on leadership. But, of course, the screening committee, all of our candidates, all of the nominees went through a screening process with all our political parties, and the best candidates were chosen for the 2015 general election. It was based on track record. It was based, of course, on the different qualities, characteristic profiling that you're looking for when you're trying to win a particular constituency. And therefore, the partnership has done its homework at the end of the day. I'm not really afraid to say this, but in the lead up to the general elections, our team and our campaign team were in some of these seats from a year before, profiling, speaking to the people on the ground, all of that, looking for the best fit for the constituency.
My actual questions now, in your capacity as the elections officer for the People's Partnership campaign, I wanted to know if you'd be willing to say who paid your nomination fee for Couva North constituency, if you're privy to the accounts of the UNC, and who are the financiers for the People's Partnership?
I cannot answer that question in its entirety. The nomination fee, of course, the treasurer of the party is the one who would have to be contacted to tell you that specific answer. I am not aware of...
So to be clear, you didn't pay your nomination fee?
Yes, I did.
So then
yes,
the treasurer
I did
not pay your
no, no. Fee. You see, when you are paying the nomination fee, you also represent a party, a political party. So the slip that is given to you, you are the UNC candidate for the constituency of Couva North. So it's a combination of party and
who fronted
candidate
the cash, is what I'm asking. Who fronted the cash?
It's not
for
cash,
the...
it's done check.
Okay, who fronted the money?
I did.
So then I don't need to ask the treasurer.
No, you ask about party financing.
All right, so
that
right,
part
so
of you your
have,
question.
Right, so you have paid for your own nomination fee. You're not privy to the accounts of the UNC. Is that what you're saying as well?
There's a level of confidentiality, and the treasurer can speak about party financing. So I think he'd be the best person to explain that.
You haven't answered my question. Are you privy to the accounts of the UNC?
Yes.
Fantastic. So you're able but unwilling to see
to
who
divulge
is the
that information. Yes.
Fantastic.
Yes.
Kendall Vincent, Youth Ambassador, CT. Good night, Minister Ramdial.
Good night.
The People's Partnership came into power in 2010. We had the first female Prime Minister, and there's been use of the gender card when convenient, my opinion personally. What would you say in regards to the... There were critics, numerous critics on social media that says that the People's Partnership did not present a diverse slate of candidates as it represents women and both youth. Could you, what is your thoughts on that? Seeing that we had the axing of one of the most, youngest performing rising stars in your party, Stacey Rupnarine. Mm-hmm. So could you comment on the lack of women and youth?
Well, I don't think there's a lack of women. Yes, there's a decreased percentage from 2010 entering mainstream politics. And as the Prime Minister would have reiterated on some of her platform speeches, there's a hesitance on behalf of women to enter mainstream politics, even state board positions. I remember in 2010 when we were fielding positions for state boards and we approached some women, and the Prime Minister said it herself, they were very hesitant to come on board to serve on state boards for many different reasons. The number one reason being that of having a family, little kids and all of that, and the demands of serving in mainstream government and mainstream politics.
One follow-up question to that.
Sure.
You said that women are a bit hesitant to present themselves to, what about the ones that did present themselves to serve and they were not? Mm-hmm. Is it that, because rumor has it as well, is that the Prime Minister, powerful female figures such as Nicole Dyer-Griffith, Verna St. Rosegraves, any female at a Carolyn Cipa Salvation, that is rumor has it that any female that is presents a threat or shines a little more than the Prime Minister, normally they are asked. Is
no,
there any truth or credence to the fact that the Prime Minister cannot take female opposition within her
no,
cabinet?
No, that's not true. The Prime Minister I know has a very open, an open door policy. She listens to everyone, their opinions, their ideas, and of course she takes it on board and in stride and would implement where necessary. So I think that's a little bit petty. Rumor has it everywhere right now. It's silly season, so you're getting it all across Trinidad and Tobago. But no, that is not true. That is not true.
Okay. Hi. Good evening. Brendan O'Brien, also representing Take Back TT. Kind of stole my question, but I'm going to press on it a little bit more.
Sure.
The current slate, for those who are wondering, the current slate of People's Partnership candidates only has 9 women. I think that's important, especially given the backdrop that in 2009, the People's National Movement presented a draft gender policy that was full of holes, but there was something present that was still relatively on someone's desk when the People's National Movement left office. The People's Partnership built their own gender policy in 2012 that for many different reasons, including response from communities of voters, for example, on the religious right in this country. There was a lot of complications around the 2012 gender policy. This afternoon, the Honorable Kamla Prasad Bisesa stated on Orange Day with the Network of NGOs for the Advancement of Women that there is now a greater impetus for partnership around women's issues and leadership around women's issues.
Yes.
That's the same rhetoric that we heard in 2012. We still haven't met a gender policy. So the question is, what does it take for the People's Partnership and the Honorable Kamla Prasad Bisesa to actually execute political will around protection and greater dignity around gender? And what really is the role of women in this People's Partnership when the representation of women to men in its lineup is not representative of the actual Trinbagonian population?
All right, I'll answer your last question first. As I said before to the previous person who asked me the question, we have had less women coming and signing up as nominees to be candidates for this general elections. That is a fact. Through the United National Congress, COP, I'm also told that there were less women coming in as nominees. So that is something that we need to address at a different level altogether. I don't know if it is because of having our first female prime minister for the past 5 years that they are somewhat disheartened to sit next to when they look at the level of criticism you know, directed towards the Prime Minister over the past 5 years.
Yeah, but if I might add to that, if I may, in the last 5 years, under the leadership of the first female Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, we've seen a larger cabinet than
yes.
since our independent history.
That is true.
With fewer women.
No, I don't think so. We have had, I mean, yes, there have been more
actually fewer women than in the previous cabinet.
We have had more male ministers in our large cabinet, as you say, but we have had a lot of women who have served. I mean, we had Venus and Rose, we had Mary King, and we had quite a number of women who, for different reasons, would, you know, have been asked to resign or leave, or you know the reasons behind some of them. It has been aired on media.
Right. If I might twist your arm a little bit, it's interesting that you call the two names Verna St. Rose Graves and Mary King,
yes.
who both served as ministers of gender, youth, and child development.
Yes.
Both had their hands in particularly interesting documents. Mary King working on the 2012
gender policy, yes.
and Verna St. Rose Graves, for one reason or another, resigning or being asked to resign after the Children's Act. So it's interesting that while we talk about the role of women,
yeah.
two women
now,
who served as gender, youth, and child development
yes.
ministers are no longer there in
for reasons that are known, right?
Well, right.
And
but that's an interesting kind
yes,
of backdrop.
Definitely. And I also served as junior minister with former Minister Verna St. Rose, and we worked on the gender policy together. And I was privy and part of all of the stakeholder consultations during that time. And there were a number of issues that were still, you know, that's still up in the air, but the gender policy is before cabinet right now. Hazel Brown supports it. I know she made a call to our Prime Minister to have cabinet accept it. And I know this Thursday in cabinet, it comes back, the gender policy comes back before cabinet this Thursday. And cabinet is going to look at it again and see whether or not we are, and they are, and we are ready to release it and have it laid.
One last question,
sure.
now that we finally sure. confirmed that there's a gender policy
yes,
before cabinet.
Yes.
Does it finally include protections for individuals of different, of alternative sexual orientations?
Yes,
that was the concern in 2012.
Yes, it speaks of no discrimination against equal opportunities in the workplace. Because, again, when we had the stakeholder consultation with Kaiso TT, that was their number one issue. Exactly. They were asking for equal opportunity in the workplace because they know that their membership, when they go for jobs and whatever, they were discriminated against. And therefore, when they came to us as being part of that ministry and working on that gender policy, they asked for that to be the first issue to be addressed. So we have that included in the gender policy of 2012.
Okay, fantastic.
Thank you very much.
Good evening, Ms. Ramdial. Dominique Williams.
Hi.
Here. You stated earlier that the move to have the Honorable Prime Minister on the forefront of the campaigning process was a strategic move. Was it also a strategic move to have phone calls made to individuals' phones with a recording of the Prime Minister and for emails to be sent? And if so, do you as an individual find that appropriate and why?
First and foremost, as you know, we live in a modern world, so we have implemented new methods and strategies with respect to electioneering. This is one strategy and method that has been implemented in first world countries, and so we decided to implement it here. It has been very successful to date, I must say. The teleforums, the emails, and of course the calls that are going out. Well, we've been engaging the population then. I'm in support of it, and therefore I don't think it's really an invasion of privacy, because sometimes when you go on Facebook, information is there. Somebody, their phone numbers are there, their addresses are there, and we are able to contact these persons via the information given on social media.
So you're stating that the access to this information was taken from social media?
From a number of different sources, not just social media, but from a number of different sources.
Can you elaborate on some of these sources?
Well, all of which I can't.
Well, some of which you stated social media.
Yeah.
Can you probably give us
also,
a couple more?
Also, you know, places of that do business. You know, there are information from the UNC membership also. We have a huge membership of more than 80,000 Trinidad and Tobago citizens. So we have that pool of information. So that's another source where we have gotten. And over the years, you know, we would have also collected data in many different ways as a party and as a partnership. I am also the director of the UNC Party School or the UNC Academy. And also when I go to the different constituencies and I meet young people like yourselves and we try to get them to come in and join the party and membership drives, we were able to get that information also. So it's from different sources we've been able to gather this information.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Very healthy dialogue taking place so far. The first round of discussion, indeed, as we have, of course, moved through this evening's edition of The Chair. Ms. Ramdial, how has it been for the first round?
Great. I love it. Okay. It reminds me of when I was a teacher.
Well,
being grilled by my students.
I know it's only going to get more interesting as we go down the road. So we're going to take a short break and come back with more. It's This Chair on STV Real TV. Tonight, we have Ms. Ramona Ramdial, our very special guest, sitting in the chair. And we'll be back with the first female guest on the show right after this.
Rise or fall in sufferers. Rise and take your stance again.